Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our thought leadership session this morning on democratising financial advice. My name is Stephen Pinner. I'm the MD at Goodacre, and I'm pleased to host the session this morning, which I'm very much looking forward to. We've got two speakers from two different companies, and I'm just going to give you a little bit of background on both companies and a little bit of background on our speakers. So we have HAYAH Insurance. So I'll introduce a speaker from HAYAH in just a moment. But HAYAH is a leading digital first life insurer in the UAE, specialising in life savings and medical insurance products. It was founded in 2008 and headquarters are in Abu Dhabi. And HAYAH is committed to providing its customers with a convenient, personalised and secure insurance experience. The digital platform makes it easy for customers to purchase, manage and track their insurance policies online or through the HAYAH app. Customers can also get in touch with their customer services team 24/7 through live chat, email or phone. They offer a wide range of products, insurance products, to meet the individual needs of individuals and families at all stages of life. Some of their more popular products are life insurance. They have a variety of insurance plans, including term life insurance, whole life insurance, etc. They have savings insurance. They have a variety of savings insurance plans and medical insurance products to cover the costs of medical expenses such as doctor visits, hospital stays and drugs and so on. The company is regulated by the Central Bank of the UAE and is listed on the Abu Dhabi Securities Exchange. HAYAH is also a member of the Emirates Insurance Association. So that's HAYAH. And then, of course, we have our friends from Kidbrooke, the software firm from Sweden that specialises in developing and delivering innovative software solutions for all business of all sizes. The company was founded in 2010, headquartered in Stockholm, and has a team of experienced and talented developers who are passionate about creating software that helps businesses to succeed. The range of services that Kidbrooke provides includes customized software development, software integration, helping to integrate existing software systems with each other and with new software solutions to improve efficiency and productivity, and software maintenance and support. So that's HAYAH and that's Kidbrooke. And just a few lines about our speakers. We have David Howard, who's the head of strategy and digital transformation at HAYAH. David has over 20 years of experience in the insurance industry, having worked at a variety of roles in the UK and the Middle East. He's passionate about using tech to improve the customer experience and make insurance more accessible and affordable. He's a strong advocate for financial inclusion and is committed to helping people of all backgrounds to achieve their financial goals. He's a Chartered Insurance Institute Fellow and holds a CII Level 4 Diploma in Insurance. So welcome, David. And then we have Erik. Erik is active in three areas: in portfolio management, market making and risk management from quant, tech and regulatory perspectives. His focus is in allocation, derivatives, fixed income, e-trading and systematic strategies. I knew I'd pronounce that incorrectly. Product development, data science, analytics and tech with focus on real-time machine learning applications, insights and data engineering. And Erik is also upfront in leadership and creating efficiency in complex environments. So welcome to our two speakers. And to get a little bit more information before we go into the questions that we want to put to them. So David and Erik, please introduce yourselves now. Tell me if I've missed anything and give us an overview of your roles within your respective companies. Perhaps David, you first.
Thank you, Stephen. Thank you for the introduction and good morning or afternoon, everybody, depending on what time zone you're located in. So as Stephen said, my name is David Howard. I'm the head of strategy and digital transformation at HAYAH Insurance. I have been in the UAE for 7.5 years. I originally moved out with friends, Provident International. I have a life and pensions background across the UK and the UAE, covering retail investment operations, product management, and implementation across both countries. At HAYAH, I look after all of the strategy, digital, and customer aspects, as well as overseeing our savings and investment products. So I look forward to discussing with Erik and you all today. Thank you.
Thanks, David. And Erik?
Yeah, thanks, Stephen, for the introduction. Hi, David. My name is Erik Brodin. I'm working at Kidbrooke as a product and sales lead. What that means is that I'm deeply involved in both sides, getting acquiring customers and then helping our customers creating good products.
Okay, thanks. So during the session, if participants want to ask questions, you know how to do that through the chat and Q&A at the bottom of the screen. So don't hesitate, and we'll do our best to answer all questions that are put forward. So, David, having worked both in the UK and the Middle East, how would you describe the financial landscape in the Middle East compared to the UK and Europe?
Well, it's very different at a very high level, and it's worth touching on a few different areas where the UAE differs from the UK. In many ways, it's a very forward-looking country, and in some others, it's like stepping into a time machine, going back to some of the behaviours that were around. I wasn't there in the 70s and 80s. So to cover a few areas, if we start with the business environment in the UAE, especially in financial services, there are very strict ownership and control rules. So as an example, insurance companies must be owned by UAE nationals. And up until 2021, that was the case in the whole of the UAE, federal UAE, for any business. It had to be, you had to have a local sponsor to be able to operate there. There's a delineation between local insurers and foreign insurance companies. The latter can only register as a branch. So it's a very closed shop in the UAE, and there's a moratorium on new insurance licenses as well. The only way in is to buy an insurance company, which means that there are a few companies here that are sitting on a small book, waiting to be acquired and selling those licenses very dearly, as that's the only way into the market. The government is not releasing any more because we have over 60 insurance companies in the UAE for a population of 12 million people. I think off the top of my head, that is more than double the number of insurance companies you'll find in India, for example. So what this means for the business environment is that very little has changed in the last few years. There's a very embedded leadership that comes from a different generation with a very different financial culture to the UK and Western Europe. It's a very traditional, broker-driven, relationship-driven market that's reliant on paper-based processes, face-to-face interactions. There's also a big divide between the local and the international insurers. The local players are more biased towards the mandatory coverages in the UAE, such as health and motor insurance. The foreign insurers are far more likely to embrace wealth management solutions. The local insurers are more likely to have the relationships with the key corporate and government entities. So there's a very clear separation between the type of business that the different insurance companies do. Example, 2 years ago, I think 0.2% of all of the saving insurance premiums were written by local companies. So 99.8% is with foreign insurers. Mm. So it's simply not a place until now, and basically HAYAH is choosing to operate in that space, where local insurers just haven't chosen to operate before now. Put all of this together, there's not been a lot of incentive to innovate. Every insurance company has had their own patch of sand that they're very comfortable sitting on. There's a very fragmented and immature regulatory environment. There's multiple regulators with some overlapping responsibilities, and they're not always aligned, which presents a challenge, as you can imagine. And where there is regulation, banking usually takes the primary focus as opposed to insurance. Insurance always comes last, sadly, in the order of operations. On the technology side, the UAE really feels that it missed out in being a leader in blockchain and crypto. Whatever you think of the technology and the solutions, the UAE does not want to miss out on the next big thing. So they are really pushing heavily Web3 and AI. They appointed the world's first minister for AI in 2017, and there's a really high level of support for free zones and fintech hubs. Those are beginning to eat into the established market shares of the insurance and the banks in the financial in the financial sector. And I've seen in my 7.5 years in Dubai a significant amount of progress. When I moved to Dubai, I couldn't even buy an ironing board online. There was no Amazon. But now everything is on an app. My government ID is all through a single app. I can, my tenancy agreement's on UAE Pass, which is a government entity. So they've really made great strides in the last few years on the technology side. And then the final clear massive difference between the UAE and the UK is clearly the consumer base. The UAE is majority expat. 90% of the country are from overseas. Primarily South Asian, Middle East, North Africa, and the Philippines. Many expats from countries with unstable currencies and a lack of modern financial solutions. There's emerging affluent and heavy blue-collar expats that are young, predominantly male. And in general, it's a very technologically advanced population, but financially illiterate compared to the UK. So it's a really interesting dynamic of a complete disparity between how the leadership of the financial sector, especially in insurance, thinks compared with the actual demographics of the country. Sorry, that was a very, very long answer, Stephen.
No, that's really good. You mentioned that they've actually got an AI minister, did you say?
That's correct. In 2017, the world's first Minister for AI was appointed by the UAE government. They're very keen to be first in a lot of things. And like I said, they are really backing AI and Web3 hard. They want to be the global leader in that segment. So really heavy focus on digital.
And is that minister very visible, David, in the business?
In terms of the financial services sector, not so much in terms of the established sector. They do take a bit of time to put regulations together. There's a lot of learning as they go along. They're trying to, when they approach regulatory challenges, they usually try and lean on examples from overseas. So you can have a look at the insurance legislation. They would lean a lot from Singapore fair regulations for commission capping. For data protection, they look to GDPR. When it comes to AI and the really forward-looking things, if there's one thing that we talk about Western democracies, it's often quite slow to come up with effective legislation. So there's not really a base there for them to lean on. So they're kind of working out as they go along. It took 5 years from that appointment for a clear digital framework to be put in place from a regulatory perspective. So it does take some time. It is becoming more visible. But generally, they've kind of viewed it more as really kind of trying to push an innovative environment, the fintech accelerators, free zones, startup hubs. That's what they're really putting their driving force behind, seeing regulation as a way to encourage innovation and not hold it back.
Great example. So, yeah, interesting. Thanks for that. So just turning to Erik. Erik, you're based in Sweden. You mentioned seeing an increased demand from the Middle East. What differentiates this region and what potential do you see there?
So I think it very much connects back to what David said. Very good explanation. Obviously, for us as a B2B provider, we kind of follow that. So what we are seeing is this need for and this want for technology. People are very open about new technology solutions. And I think David then explained why the reasons for that is they don't want to miss out. And that is a very different discussion than we're having in Europe and UK. It's much more forward-looking. Also, what we are seeing in our field working with financial analytics is the need for particularly pension solutions and saving solutions. Our take on this is that people are staying longer in UAE than before, which means that they need to have solutions. And as you have this technology digitalization trends, they want digital solutions. I think also what David touched upon was that some places are relying on manual work more than digital solutions. And what we are seeing there is when you're talking to clients that things are going pretty slow in discussions, it's more curiosity. But the thing is, when people decide they want to do things, it's going very, very fast. I think the decision processes is very different. It's much swifter when a company wants to do something in UAE than just do it. And in Europe and UK, it's more stakeholder management, etc., the usual decision layers, which means as a provider, you need to kind of be relevant, of course. But then when a decision is coming up, you really need to move swift.
Sorry, and you said there, Erik, that they're more proactive in the Middle East. And you, is that compared to Europe generally?
No, it's from my perspective there, it's as they're coming from a not that mature digitalized world or regulatory world, they are obviously, we feel that they are looking what is working in other regions.
Right.
So obviously they're preparing for the future, and once they decide that they want to do it, they act fast.
Interesting. And would you say, as somebody that's actually offering support and services out to these companies in the Middle East, what sort of competition do you come across when you're actually reaching out to those firms in that area? Are there many firms? I mean, you're in Sweden and you're being successful there. Are many other European firms or UK firms actually competing for business there?
From our perspective, we are pretty successful in our sales processes regarding HAYAH. So I think that question is more to David, how he regards the competition. But what we are seeing is this probing of solutions and then the decision to either go ahead or not. So we don't really know our competition full out. We are very happy the way we are progressing in the area.
Oh.
And I think that boils down to that we have this advanced technology, which is still transparent, which is a good fit.
Okay, interesting. Okay, well, I'm sure we'll come back to that. Thanks, Erik. David, coming back to you, can you throw some light, please, on HAYAH's decision to build a digital insurance business, what the core objectives were, and how did your planning journey come to life? How did you prepare for all of this?
Well, a very big trigger for us was, if I go back in time a couple of years, we were an AXA company. We were AXA Green Crescent. So it was a joint venture between our UAE-based owners and AXA, obviously well-known multinational company. Mm. What comes with the AXA environment is mandated standards and controls, which means that the pace of the development is very slow. When AXA exited from the Middle East 2 years ago, it gave us an opportunity to reset. So despite what I was saying previously about the amount of technological progress in the UAE, the insurance industry has a collective ostrich mentality and sticking their heads in the sand. The leadership's often...
That doesn't apply to the speed at which they increase their premiums. But anyway, carry on.
No, not at all. There's definitely they're very hot on profits there, Stephen. I can tell you that much. The leadership, because of the environment, has never needed to be exposed to modern solutions or respond to competitive challenges. Insurance is still sold physically in bricks and mortar shops with paper face-to-face and motorcycle couriers ferrying policy documents around Dubai. So with that lack of competitive pressure, there's no innovation. So when we have the opportunity for a reset, we were left with a choice of a Me Too proposition, doing the same thing, or fundamentally changing our approach. Now, I don't want to make it sound like it was a massive groundbreaking decision. We're absolute trailblazers in global insurance. It's simply a case of the UAE insurance industry was so far behind what you see in Western Europe, and in surrounding countries in the Middle East, it's even further behind than in the UAE. We can see what's happening in Western Europe and UK. I'm obviously from the UK, and I see the development that's happened in terms of the availability of digital solutions in insurance. So we decided to say, well, we know what's coming. Like, eventually this is going to happen in the UAE. We know local companies are not operating in this space, so we'll fill that space as a digitally capable local insurer that offers wealth solutions. So that those digital solutions you mentioned during the intro, that we're very keen on financial inclusivity, that allows us to tap into the underserved segments with a very broker heavy, very commission hungry environment out here. There are so many people, nearly half the expats in the UAE are blue collar. They can't afford traditional, like, old school investment advice where you pay an absolute fortune and you need to pay at least $250 per month into a savings plan. Your construction worker or your cab driver can't afford that.
Mm.
So there's a clear direction of travel with the UAE government looking to local companies and licensed financial institutions to provide those solutions. They want to onshore the talent, they want to onshore the risk, the profits, and we're more than happy to step into that void.
Really interesting, David. And a couple of things there. You mentioned that under the AXA banner, the decision-making process was slow. So I'd like you to comment on that. And the other thing, just coming out of what you just said, in terms of your sort of peer group out there, is there a race now that people have seen what you've done? Are there other companies sort of rushing to catch up with this sort of digital transformation of their businesses?
In respect of AXA, it is just a very procedural manner to launch new products, new propositions. And Paris still holds a lot of sway over the decision-making process. So it's just simply a factor of time and how complex the process is. When AXA leaves, we can remove that layer of decision-making. So naturally, we can make decisions much quicker. In terms of what our competitors in the region are doing, Zurich are one of the key international players, and in general, they've got some reasonable digital solutions. They've obviously got the benefit of being a multinational company. And there's one local player called Sukoon, formerly Oman Insurance, that is making some steps in terms of digital transformation. Mm. But in terms of catching up to what HAYAH is trying to do, because we've gone the way we're going, we're trying to be more consumer focused and not joining the advised distribution rat race that's in the UAE. There are certain things that we can do that our competitors can't. They cannot afford to upset their key broker contacts. And because there are capital requirements for broker firms, all the broker firms out here are very big, and often a relationship with a broker firm can make or break your business out here. So we're just trying to diversify and not be too tied to a single distribution avenue. That gives us an advantage that our competitors do need to keep their brokers in mind and can't necessarily say, here's a digital proposition that's much cheaper than this advised proposition, because the advisors will be up in arms about being undercut.
Okay. All right, Dave, thanks. This is a question really for both of you. So, HAYAH as an insurer and Kidbrooke as the technology provider enabling digital advice, how do you see financial advisors fitting in the competitive landscape going forward? Perhaps you could start on that one, Erik.
Yes, and I think that's an important point to discuss, especially in kind of the environment of AI, and people are thinking AI will replace people. I actually been working and done research on AI before it was called AI. And for me, it's always being tools that enhance people. So you make people more efficient. And for me, that's for an advisor. An advisor is an important part of the ecosystem. People are different. Some people like to do stuff themselves, doing self-service, digital services. Other people like having a good relationship with a human being, trusting an advisor and helping them. What is important, I think, and what we are seeing is the consistency of numbers. If a advisor gives advice based on facts, it should always be the same numbers in a self-service setting. Otherwise, people get confused. What we also are seeing is that if an advisor have digital channels like self-service, they actually have more business because people tend to use the advisors as confirmations of their own thoughts.
Yeah.
Obviously, then the consistent numbers is important. So for us, we see that people are doing things. If you are a digital person and want to do it self-service, you do it. But then a lot of people want to walk to the advisor and then have the advice confirming their views. Obviously, with the technology, you can enhance the advisor significantly. You can make them better. You can make them more relevant. You can help them automate processes. You can be proactive in looking into the financials situations of the clients on scale using technology. So for me, it's an active part of the ecosystem, which always will stay. And I think you just need to adapt to technology to consider that for becoming a more efficient advisor.
That's a really good point, Erik, actually, that the number of people that, that they trawl for information, they're quite happy to do things, or not a lot of people, but they want that extra bit of confirmation from the advisor. So, yeah, really relevant point. And David, same point to you.
Largely, I agree with everything that Erik said. I think we can all agree that the regulatory burden has not declined over the last 15 years. And in the future, will not decline then either. This applies to both insurance and the insurers and the advisory community. So each increase of that regulatory burden raises the bar for, unfortunately, putting the hard-nosed business hat on, for the value that a customer needs to bring to be profitable to service. So technology, such as what we're using with Kidbrooke, is an enabler that allows that bar to be lowered and advice to be made available to people who often need it the most, the people that don't have the understanding and really need the guidance through the financial landscape. Despite what I said about the advisory practices in the UAE, there will always be a need for human interaction, whether that's simply consumer preference or complex needs, as Erik outlined. And I really see that the success stories of tomorrow will be the companies, whether it's insurers or advisors or technology providers, that can successfully marry the technology with the traditional approaches.
Just a quick point on that, David. You mentioned regulation there. In the Middle East, are you faced with the sea of regulatory challenges that we get, certainly because the UK's out of the EU now, and because we've got all of that sort of transformation about, you know, being singularly regulated, if you like, in the UK, and we've now got things like consumer duty changes that have come in fairly recently. Do you see, do you have the same sort of tsunami of regulatory challenges out there?
The pace of change is quickening, certainly. Up to a few years ago, there was a specific insurance authority that regulated the insurers. That was absorbed into the central bank of the UAE that now oversees the banks and the insurers together. And since then, the pace of change has really increased. For a long time, the environment out here was described as the Wild West. Anything went, there were no commission caps. There was a lot of mis-selling, the kind of behaviours that the Western European and the UK tried to stamp out with the likes of RDR. Yeah. So we're seeing that regulatory burden increase. Commission capping came in a couple of years ago. The way that the regulations are imposed still needs a little bit of development, a little bit more maturity. In the UK, there's a very well-defined pathway, a lot more industry interaction, and then a lot more oversight of the regulations before they come into force. I know some people may not think that, I think I'm talking absolute rubbish, but I'm talking in a relative sense to sometimes what we see in the UAE, where regulations done with the best of intentions, but sometimes isn't always completely thought through. So one example of that, in 2016, when I moved out, there was an announcement to say that we're bringing in commission caps and it will happen in 6 months. Mm. 4.5 years later, it was finally implemented. Yeah. So it can be a bit variable. The enforcement is variable, but they are gradually moving to a more sophisticated regulatory environment, which we're very happy that it's going in that direction. It is, whilst the regulatory burden is increasing, it is becoming a bit simpler to follow.
Okay. I mean, one of the reasons for putting that question back to you is that obviously that, you know, changing regulations has an impact on the technology that you use, you know, and making sure that the technology is in line and so on and so forth. So it's quite important you've got the right sort of technical fintech infrastructure that you can support changes as and when they come without major upheaval or new systems. So look, thanks for that. So Erik, how was collaborating with Kidbrooke helping HAYAH differentiate itself in the highly competitive insurance market? Are there any additional innovative financial planning journeys in the pipeline that you can tempt and tease our audience with today?
I think this question should also be kind of stated to David, but I think we will discuss that later on. Obviously, we have a partnership, which we really like. We are working on things together. I think that's a key thing. The way we are seeing is that a lot of digitalization is based on mathematics, analytics, and data. Usually in large organizations, that become a blocker. You kind of build a solution which is only working for one use case. Then also, as mathematics can be complex, you have a lot of worrying within an organization from stakeholders. Are we doing this right? Can we do it in a different way? People of various degree of knowledge having opinion on mathematics. I think what we provide is that we provide software which solves current use cases from an analytic perspective. Basically call it analytic on tap. But what is important is that will also hold going forward. So you can scale this solution technology, analytically, but also regulatory. So you can move much faster in your product development. In other companies, usually you have significant discussions and worries about the math that are supposed to solve the digitalization. I think that is one thing that we are bringing to the table, solving things now, but also solving things for the future. What we are innovating with, which I think is really interesting, is not only pensions for one individual, but actually pension retirement management for an entire company. How do you do that? In some countries, regulations, etc., it's more about asset liability management, liquidity management of the company level, which stems for your saving and retirement funds for your customers. I think that is a really interesting item to kind of innovate in. How do you provide tools for retirement on company level, not just individual?
Interesting. And David, what do you have in the pipeline going forward? Things that you can tell us about without giving the game away to your competitors?
Sure. Well, I'm happy to give the game away, Stephen. I will stick my flag in the sand and say I don't think they can follow us. We originally challenged Kidbrooke to support a self-service savings journey that would provide a more realistic view for prospective customers. You mentioned in terms of technology and regulation, the central bank expects financial institutions to educate their customers. As you can imagine, there's a lot of lip service paid to that, but it's something that we want to set. Here is our clear blue ocean between us and our competitors. We are taking this to heart and developing a solution that is better than just a 6% exponential growth curve. We've given you a range of outcomes to help you understand and have a better expectation of how your savings will perform. That's what we challenged them to do, and Kidbrooke delivered that pre-sales. We are developing that post-sale as well. We do not want to be an insurer just sells a product and disappears until you stop paying your premium or make a claim. That's not who we are. But we can leverage that technology solution to give you a financial health checkup on an automated basis. So you get a bit of a warning if something's happened and the analysis says that you're not as likely to meet your goals as you were before.
Yeah.
There are a lot of other things that we want to work on. Pensions is a hot topic in the UAE right now. And Erik touched upon how companies manage their pension liabilities. And that very much is something that is, well, we're already involved with it. We launched a couple of years ago, but developing those additional service propositions for companies, and again, I sort of come back to the culture differences, that where the leadership, the HR leadership, the CFOs, the CEOs have come from countries that don't have a pension provision. So they're not as familiar with a retirement solution, a pension solution, as their counterparts in the UK may be.
I was going to ask you about that, actually, David. Have you got the same sort of legislation out there that makes it mandatory for companies to offer up pensions?
It's currently a sort of defined benefit approach. It's a lump sum end of service gratuity based on your length of service that's a multiplier of your final salary up to 200%. That's broadly the retirement environment in the GCC, a lump sum paid when you finish employment with the country. A couple of years ago, one of the free zones replaced that with a more traditional DC solution. And last month, Sheikh Mohammed announced that for Dubai, that any company can voluntarily switch from the current end of service gratuity model to a DC model, which really we're really happy about. We've got the solution already in the market. But it's to show you how slow the wheels turn. That was first mooted back in 2009, first federal discussions in terms of reform of pension benefit. As companies building up this liability for end of service on their books, and over 80% of companies not provisioning for it at all. So you can imagine what happened when COVID hits and you need to lay off a bunch of staff. There's certainly a massive shock if you're having to pay that from your working capital. So they've seen the systemic problems. The first step is making it voluntary. We expect it will become mandatory and become the new model. So a very familiar structure that we'll all be used to in the UK.
Okay. And one thing I wanted to ask earlier on, but I'll just come back to it now. Where you are within your insurance organisation, I'm not sure how difficult it would be to recruit people with fintech skills. And you know, is that a real challenge for you there? And is that another reason why that you've turned to somebody like Kidbrooke, who's got all of that, the skill sets and experience and the support that you can actually rest on? Has that been a challenge in terms of finding technically aware people?
It's a really interesting question in terms of the competencies that are available in the market. Now, in terms of our approach, we are a very lean organization. We don't want to inflate and bloat ourselves with a lot of FTEs. So our usual model is to find partners that we can work with, where we can integrate via APIs, rather than in-housing some of that development resource ourselves. We're not going to sit here and build from scratch a huge wealth planning system. We're going to kind of de-risk the technology aspect of it by finding expert partners. That being said, the UAE is really adjusting its visa environment. They've introduced a golden visa. So if you're in certain areas, talent, so literally presenting talent, science, finance, actuaries, and software development, you can apply to the government for a golden visa, which essentially gives you a 10-year visa, and that's not linked to needing to be employed to have a visa. So they're doing their best to attract these kind of people. And the tech side is incredibly vibrant. With the fintech accelerators, a lot of startups, there's a lot of VC funding in the region, a lot of funding coming from the government to these kind of initiatives. So there's so many events, so many conferences on the tech space. And that's just evidence of the push that the government's given it. For the more traditional skill sets that companies would be looking for, that can be a bit more of a challenge, if I'm honest. Part of that is cultural. People are coming to the UAE from surrounding countries who are less developed. And we're trying to kind of develop a solution that's on par with the very best that North America and Europe has to offer. And sometimes those skills aren't always available in the market.
Interesting. Thanks for that. Erik, would you say that the trend of leveraging technology to build digital financial advice and guidance journeys is also relevant for the UK European audience? And if you do, why is that?
Yeah, I think that's actually interesting how kind of sides shifts. We have talked a lot about the growing digitalization in UAE, technology perspective, etc. So what's interesting from a Europe and UK perspective is consumer duty and also retail investment package in EU. So that's new regulatory legislations. And from our point of view, and when you think about it and talk about it, you need to solve that through technology. So I think actually it's becoming even more relevant in UK and Europe the last year, just due to these regulations. So we expect now to see a push within the area. People are really moving their digital agenda forward for the sake of consumers.
Interesting. Just as a sort of side comment on that, Erik, when you talk to organisations about digital transformation, do you find that the stakeholders and senior management at these firms actually get it, or do you think that they're just playing catch up?
Well, I think everyone gets it, because when you kind of listen to Spotify or your you have entered the digital world, so everyone knows that this will happen going forward. So for me, when you talk with business leaders, decision makers, stakeholders, it's more about timing within the organization. What is the most important thing to do right now? And I think that's why you always need to be staying relevant, because you cannot push the timing of a company's digital transformation. Obviously, with regulation, that gets things done faster. We saw home working with Corona that suddenly made a digital leap in the entire world. So for me, it's always been on the agenda, but it's not just old school business cases. Should I do it? Should I not do it? What happened if I do it? I need to prioritize it with other things.
One of the reasons I asked that question is that you mentioned consumer duty just then. I touched on it earlier on. Consumer duty is a relatively new set of regulations. But it seemed to me, and I may have got this wrong, that many companies, although they had a long run-up to the introduction of that regulation, many companies seem to either leave it too late to think about getting their tech in place to make sure that they comply, or they went on journeys with the wrong providers, which sort of made them late in the day. So we're already hearing some challenges that are coming out in the back of that. And that's why I really sort of put that question to you.
Yeah, and from my perspective, it's about urgency within our organization, especially a large one. Everyone is not always pulling in together in one direction. So you need to have a little bit of a crisis, and then suddenly everyone start to work really well together. And obviously also regulation can be a bit abstract. What should I really do? Then it's hard to kind of have that commitment from an organization to really solve a problem. So I think it's only human that people are thinking about it still and have a little bit of struggles. One good example is it's data that is fueling everything. We call it data paralyzing. What happens is organization is that they start in this agile or waterfall way of working, and the requirement of what the data do we need to have to solve the problem. And they fairly quickly discover that they don't have the data and need to spend years getting the data. What we prefer is kind of the other way around. You start to build solutions with the data you have.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, you kind of fix the data and get more data. And I think that is something that happens in many organizations, that when it's not so important to do stuff, you build the fundamentals instead of kind of solving the use case for the business. But then suddenly with regulators, you kind of push.
Absolutely. And can I just sort of sneak in another quick question for you, Erik? When you're going into a prospective user firm for your services or your advice, do you find that there is a pushback sometimes from people that are actually running the fintech operation within the firm, that they actually don't want the outside firm to come in, and they're trying to persuade the senior management actually they can deliver this solution much better, much quicker, because they're involved in the business? Sorry, David, this is not for you to comment. This is one for Erik.
Well, so I actually taken a PhD in math. That was pretty hard work. Yeah. I said B2B sales is much harder. Yeah. Because you don't really know from the outside about the politics, who are the decision makers, who are pulling, who are not pulling. So it's kind of an interesting problem to solve. How do you sell to a big organization? Mm-hmm. And obviously then you kind of meet what you're saying, that you have pushbacks. You're talking to one level. In some companies at that level, they can take a decision. In other companies, even the board is involved. And obviously you don't meet the board at the first meeting. You have people with their own agenda, which is, you understand, they're having a career. They think other solutions are better than ours. So it takes time. It takes a lot of time.
Yeah, we've seen many examples in our business of companies that have gone down the road of sort of preferring to create technology in-house, only to end up with, you know, huge costs and often abandoned projects. That's why I asked that question. Anyway,
may I add another thing? That's something that we talked about with HAYAH introduction there with the Middle East, is that I think that is very interesting. Working with HAYAH is very fast-paced. And I think that could be challenges for service providers, that they are used to these slow processes, then they can prepare. And then they can start working. But the interesting thing here in UAE and especially with HAYAH is that you need still to have the organization that handles B2B sales and delivering to a slow-paced organization. But you need to be quick working with HAYAH because we are moving fast.
Sure. And of course, you know, people should do what they're good at. If you're an insurance company, provide insurance services. If you're a tech company, you provide tech services. Yeah. And that's the thing. So, okay, moving on, because we're running out of time. So question back to you, David. How does leveraging Kidbrooke's financial simulation engine improve your customer journeys, and why did you choose them?
Well, in terms of our customer journeys, we now have the only straight-through journey for buying savings online amongst insurers that gives you a bespoke view of your own investment portfolio selections. So from an education perspective, it's way ahead of what our competitors can do. Coming back to meeting that mandate from the central bank about educating customers. Why Kidbrooke? It's of importance for us to find a valuable partnership with a mutual benefit and not just a provider-client relationship. I think, Stephen, what you just said about people should do what they're good at, I 100% agree. I wouldn't begin to understand the quant things that Erik can talk about, and I'm not about to start trying. What I am looking for, and I can talk for a long time about B2B sales from the being sold to side of the argument, in that I am looking for somebody who can come in and say, this is a use case. And they show me that they really understand what they're trying to sell. And they'll come to me and saying, this is a technology. That's just far too common error I see in people trying to sell to me. They say, oh, I can do 1, 2, 3, 4, A, B, C, D. Great, but what does it mean for me? And Kidbrooke was able to really make that clear, support that. We can track the experience with the mathematical analysis. We have materials that we can share with the regulator if we're ever challenged on what we're doing for consumers. Add to that that we operate in a modular way and utilize API connectivity that Kidbrooke can support. So we've got a really high degree of flexibility and customization when it comes to the integration. We did go through an RFP process looking at a number of providers. We looked at affordability, front and back end compatibility with our environment, allied with modern technology, knowledge and experience. And Kidbrooke certainly ticked all the boxes, whereas I think slightly older companies are a little bit more cumbersome. And again, what Eric was talking about in terms of sort of like a lot of layers, a big slow moving company, to a certain extent it applies to some of the tech providers as well, that they don't have the pace that we're looking for. They turn around and say, oh, this will take 6 months, it's a custom build and will take forever. We need to move quicker. We're trying to keep ahead of the game here.
Interesting. And even with the benefit of hindsight, David, in terms of when you were reaching out and looking for somebody that could provide the solutions that you've now got, how difficult was that sort of modelling, planning, prediction, shaping of what you wanted to, going back, did you have a very, very clear view of what you wanted to achieve when you went on this journey in the first place?
We certainly had an overarching customer strategy that we wanted to be a provider that was with the customer every step of the way. How exactly that looks, we were open to suggestions, and we can work with Kidbrooke to define what they are. Eric and the team give us ideas to consider based on their expertise. And again, experts should do what they're expert in. So we were certainly happy to listen to the external advice we were getting.
Okay. And Eric, putting you on the spot again. So on average, how long does it typically take to build a robust digital investment journey like HAYAH's Smart Saver product?
So just to be clear, it's we are one part of an entire journey. I think one thing that we take pride in is that we always think about the end client of the solution, not kind of selling to a business partner. So what we have done is that we have put a lot of efforts in building a generic solution for the future, which means that we can move pretty fast. It's basically understanding the investment universe that HAYAH is having, adding a couple of more risk factors like inflation, etc., understanding the economy. But after that, we are ready to go. So from our part, it's a couple of weeks exercise, depending then on the investment universe. What we also do is that we work in the way that we provide demos. So integration work will go much swifter because people are seeing actually what will happen and can follow in the API calls, etc. So pretty straightforward.
Okay. Thank you. David, do you have any feedback that you can offer our viewers on learning since the release of your journey that you could be comfortable in sharing today?
Sure. It's to be honest, it's not much of a technical learning, but more that we need to find a way to simplify the journey and our customers' minds even further. So it's very much on the HAYAH side. We've got a very clear graph that displays a round range of outcomes. What we're seeing is that there's a real passion across all socioeconomic groups in the UAE when engaging with the kind of solutions we have to offer, whether it's our Smart Saver journey, whether it's our pension. We've given, but one of my teams given a presentation in Hindi to a team of construction workers. And they are super excited to be seeing what for them is a new solution. But with a lack of financial literacy comes a suspicion of the unknown. So really the challenge for HAYAH is how can we build a better user experience, customer experience framework around this journey? Is the next step for us. That's our main learning, and it's more a qualitative one than a technical one.
Thanks, Dave, for that. Okay, so considering the evolving landscape, this is for both of you, really. Could you elaborate on how you see retirement planning changing in the Middle East? Do you think that the landscape in the Middle East will evolve to resemble the industry standards in the OECD? So I don't know, Eric, could you throw some light on that?
Yes. So what I'm seeing is obviously when people start to think about retirement, etc., you realize that you probably need more money than you expect to get. and that's why kind of these customer journeys and analytics are really helpful. I think also the standard in OECD is more the way that UAD is AID are moving. You don't want to have default risk on a company on retirements. You want the savings to be secured for the people that are getting the retirement. So I think that perspective will be also more important to understand going forward, actually on company level. How should I do with my liquidity planning, asset liability management for retirements? So I see a larger increase, and obviously I'm moving more to USD landscape.
And David?
For the UAE specifically, in terms of resembling the OECD, for me, the simple answer is yes. Firstly, the UAE is uniquely positioned to be a geopolitically neutral financial hub. Mm-hmm. And the government is aware at a strategic level that they have this opportunity. To do that, they need to be an attractive and accessible place to do business for all cultures around the world. So some of the free zones operate under England and Wales law as opposed to Sharia. We talked a little bit about regulation draft and taking pieces from other jurisdictions. Also, when the UAE was placed on the FATF grey list, that accelerated the collaboration between the UAE authorities and other regulatory bodies around the world. So I fully expect the future flavour of the retirement landscape to be very Western in nature. And I would expect that the GCC, the rest of the GCC, would be likely to follow suit as well.
Okay. I'm going to move on now to future outlooks, because we've only got two or three minutes left, and I think future is very important. So given the pace of technology evolution and market dynamics, where do you both see the future of digital first investment guidance headed in the next 5 years, say? So, Erik?
I think it's everyone needs to be comfortable with their financial situation as of now and going forward. What's happening now is that you have solutions in savings, you're having retirement. So, and that's only parts of the puzzle. I have me, I have my family. So I think in the future, it will be more holistic solutions. If I buy a car now, how will that might that affect my financial situation in when I retire, etc. I think if you don't use technology and obviously mathematics modeling and customer journeys to make people understand that, I think people will not feel safe. So I think that will be going forward, the more holistic approach. What will happen now and how can I plan for the future? And that either through self-service or through advisors.
Okay. David?
I'll build on that with sort of a couple of points. One, I think companies that create the necessary foundations to leverage the technology will be the winners of tomorrow. They're often false dawns with all of the new tech. We're on a webinar and we're not on the metaverse, for example. But I see the failures with new technology, such as the really, really buzz ones, being on a structural level rather than the concept. As Gen Z customers become the emerging affluent and the leaders of the future, they'll bring with them an innate understanding of what the technology can do and an expectation of how that's consumed. So they're growing up with AI-powered solutions. They're going to expect to see them. They're going to be the ones building them and putting them into place in businesses, if not now, then very soon. And if companies don't follow, then there's a risk of being left behind if you don't bet on the right horse. Secondly, I think one of the key things that's already beginning to sort of hit the media is really like the provenance of what advice is given to consumers. The lawsuits around what ChatGPT has been trained on and what Midjourney uses for image generation, for example. There is an awareness amongst consumers, well, where is this data coming from? And the industry needs to be in a position where we can be absolutely certain that we're providing trusted advice. So I think there's going to be, over the coming couple of years, a bit of wrestling for regulatory bodies to do in terms of managing some of the risks with the latest technologies, in terms of AI being the obvious example. But it's a very exciting time. And I really see AI being not just a buzzword, but something that can be leveraged and not a bit iffy, such as blockchain and crypto.
That's really helpful. And fun enough, I wish we had time for a poll question. We don't. But it's interesting for me to see how many people are using AI now in every day that they go to work. I know from my point of view, I think it's a wonderful thing. We have to be very careful about some of the engines that we use. But you can just see that this is going to make such a significant difference to everything that we do. David, Erik, thank you very much for your candid and forthright views and opinions. Really helpful. I'm sure that's been very useful to everybody that's tuned in. I thank you for your efforts. Taking part in these sessions is never easy. But Erik, David, thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of your day. And everybody that's tuned in, if you want CPD from this particular session, give your feedback on the Goodacre website and a certificated CPD confirmation will be sent to you. Thanks again, David, Erik, and have a good rest of the day. Goodbye now.
Thank you, Stephen. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephen.
Bye-bye.